final presentation will be done by Dr. Manoj Edirisuriya, MBBS, MD, MRCP, EDIC. He is a consultant intensivist attached to the National Hospital of Sri Lanka. And again, an interesting topic. Should we intubate all at the end? Thank you.
Right. Good morning, everybody. Thank you, CCP, for the invitation. So basically, I was on a call. So this is actually last evening. The call is that there is a request for an ICU bed, right? So they were requesting an ICU bed for a patient. So this was the we are in trouble with a deteriorating patient who is 78 years old and admitted 4 weeks ago. Patient was basically in the ward for a month with child C cirrhosis with recurrent NCAP. And he has developed multiple episodes of sepsis and received ICU care twice during this period. So now, because of the rapid deterioration, they have intubated the patient again and are looking for an ICU bed. Right. So probably this is not one of the rarest requests that you encounter during your career as an intensivist. So the question is, should we intubate everybody at the end? Right. Probably if you carefully look at the logo of the Ceylon College of Physicians, part of the answer may be there. So I'm not sure whether you can focus on this three words, cure, relief, and comfort, right? So probably we are going to talk about something related to that. So why is it important to discuss about this particular topic? So in other words, I'm not going to discuss about the drugs, techniques, and the current advances of intubation, or more precisely, the endotracheal intubation. But we are talking about the taking control of a deteriorating or a seriously ill patient's physiology, right? So this is what is meant by intubation to us all who are working in the intensive care, right? So if you are taking the control of a seriously or critically ill patient, there should be an answer to this question: what are we going to achieve, right? So obviously the patient should be benefited, right? So how do we know that this patient is going to be benefited? So it's not going to be an easy question, and there is no probably right or wrong answer unless you are thoroughly into the subject, right? So why do we care? So now, when the intensive care was started in the late 1950s, so world mortality rate, if you look at, is 100%, right? Is it because that intensive care was not that established by that time? So if you look at the world mortality rate in subsequent years, it still remains the same. So what is the simple message? So intensive care has not basically, or intubation has not basically changed the world mortality rate. So this advent of all these sophisticated and advanced techniques and developments in the science and technology has led to invent large number of life sustaining machines which would help us to keep some of the seriously ill patients alive. Does that mean that we can, find the answer to this specific question, whether any of these machines are going to change the world mortality, right? So basically, if you are taking the control over, the patient should be benefited, and patient suffering or the agony should not be extended because of this the advancement of the medicine, science, and technology, right? So for us to understand this, we'll have a brief look at what the critical illness is. So basically, when you are looking at a critically ill patient, so you encounter different setup, you know, different sorts of patients with different diagnoses. But what we have understood is finally, most of them takes a common path, right? Initial insult may be different, but finally, they will struggle with their organ functions, vital organ functions. However, some of them are, you know, the cause of the illness may not be exactly the same. So there may be different trajectories of illness. So it is very important to understand these trajectories of illness in order to see whether taking the control of these critically ill patients will really benefit them. So if you look at this first diagram, what we call is slow burn. So there is an insult to their physiology. So their level goes down and it won't go down that fast, but it takes time. Then over the days, weeks, or maybe months, patient's condition goes down. And unless there is an intervention for a reversible illness, patient will end up with the inevitable, right? So then second diagram, so we call it a big hit, where the physiology drastically go down from the point of insult, and with certain interventions, or maybe because of the patient's physiological reserves, patient might be able to catch up some level of physiology back, but they are obviously not coming back to the baseline, and still they are going down unless there is an obvious reversible factor. So the third one is called relapsing and recurrences sort of trajectory, where insult is there, their physiology goes down, they try to come back to the normal, again there is an insult, they goes down, so it recurs. So if you look at the whole the population of critically ill patients, you might encounter this sort of different presentations. So finally, what we need to understand is most of them takes a common path. It may be related to the cytokine storms. It may be due to the dysregulated host immune response. But unless you know, or unless you can predict what the outcome is going to be, we never know whether there is any point of taking the control. So then how are we going to design on the intensive care admissions, or what we were discussing this taking the control over? So when we talk about the intensive care admissions, so not all the patients who are critically ill will be benefited by intensive care admissions, right? So if the patient is too well, you know that the intensive care setup itself is a very toxic environment, and nobody would like to go inside. And so too well patients are not really destined to go into the intensive care, as you all can understand. And when you are too sick also, you will not be benefited by intensive care admission because of several factors. So when we select patients for intensive care admissions, we consider certain things. That one of the most important thing is that the reason for the organ dysfunction should be due to a reversible and identifiable treatable cause. Secondly, this organ dysfunction itself should not be to a level which is very decompensated, that it is not reversible, right? So organ dysfunction should be reversible. And thirdly, the patients should be having a capacity to come back to the previous physiology or near normal previous physiology. For that, they need to have physiological reserves. What do you mean by physiological reserves? That their organ, chronic organ functions should be fairly stable to fight the critical illness. Fourth point is that they should be able to enjoy quality life after this intensive care admission, because we all know intensive care stay is not going to be without complications. So at the end of the treatment period, they should be able to enjoy a quality life. So we will not admit the two extremes, but there may be a category of patients who will be benefited by intensive care admission. Right. Finally, even if the four criteria that I have mentioned are fulfilled, still, but this is what is going to decide the intensive care admission, strain ICU bed capacity. So you all know that ICU bed capacity is different from country to country, region to region. And there is a lot of discussions going on regarding the ICU bed capacity these days related to this ongoing pandemic. And we are somewhere around three ICU beds per million, 100,000 population in Sri Lanka, which is a little lower than the UK numbers. But other countries are rapidly escalating their capacities. So important thing is that we need to know our limits, whether we can really expand. So how much we can expand will depend on the GDP and the amount of the health budget allocated. So if you look at this diagram, so you can see this Sri Lanka is one of the countries where lowest health budget is there, less than 3% of the GDP. So it's really difficult to increase the intensive care capacity because it's very costly. And if you really want to increase the intensive care capacity, what will be happen is that you need to drag some funds from the primary healthcare, which is going to be the backbone of the good health indexes that we enjoy in our country, right? So basically, we might go against the public health interest in that sense if you really want to increase the intensive care bed capacities. So probably we need to find an answer for this. So these are the figures in the intensive care unit that I'm working. So these are a couple of years ago. So if you look at the requests for intensive care admissions, most of them are genuine requests. They are really ill and will be benefited if they are admitted to the intensive care. But if you compare the amount of admissions, the number of patients, don't know whether it's fortunate or unfortunate enough to come to the intensive care unit. So it's very difficult to fill this gap because of the constraints in the resources. So in other words, admitting to the ICU itself, will it be similar to the outcomes of the high income countries? But we know that is not similar, and we can't just extrapolate the ICU outcomes of high income to the lower middle income. That's why I said increasing the number of beds per se will not give us an answer. So if you look at the number of patients admitted to the intensive care, sorry for the this thing. So 60% of the patients are intubated by the time of admission. What does that mean? So that means the number of patients, majority of the patients admitted to the intensive care in our setup are reasonably decompensated by the time they are admitted to the intensive care. So then their stay is going to be longer, their organ dysfunctions are severe, so their outcome is not going to be good. So on the other hand, that they are going to block the beds for a longer period of time with or without a good outcome. So then more patients will be decompensated at the other end in the ward areas. So if you look at the course of the illness, so you get the insult. So their physiological functions are going down. So they enter a area of reversible organ dysfunction, as Dr. Varuni showed in the previous presentation. And then what will happen if you don't take the appropriate action? They will enter an irreversible period of organ dysfunction. So unfortunately, a significant proportion of the patients admitted to our intensive care units are in this range of irreversible region. That's why I said their outcomes are not necessarily going to be good. So what we need to do is we need to catch them early. That is why the early warning scores are there. And then they should be working with the intensive care or critical care to admit them early in order to be benefited by the intensive care treatments, which are toxic and very expensive. So intensive care is about the managing potentially reversible physiological instability in patients who need organ support and invasive monitoring. So how can we improve this? So we are talking about the interfaces in care. So when a patient admits to the hospital for acute care, so it's not about the separate specialties, but they go through a continuum of different specialties to get the treatments. So we can't work in isolation. We can't work in so then we need to have sort of interfaces, interactions with the other specialties. So how do we improve on that? So there is a growing interest, but nobody knows how best to do that. So we need to, one thing is that we need to improve the critical care outreach, rapid response systems to identify them early, as Dr. Varuni clearly explained the previous talk. And so we know the difficulty, but still we need to increase the availability of critical care services. So admission to the intensive care is not going to give you, per se, it's not going to give you the answer. So we need to define the goals of ICU admission. Sometimes when the patient is struggling to breathe, everybody think that ICU admission is the answer, but it may not be the answer. So we need to clearly define the goals of ICU admission. And also one of the focus of this discussion is that the appropriate palliative and end-of-life care paths should be available to find a reasonable answer to this issue. And training is very important. So how do we assess the critical care outcomes in resource-limited settings, which is very important, because without knowing that, we can't improve these interfaces and we can't improve the delivery of care. So we know, if you look at the right-hand bottom corner, so the mortality rates of the intensive care admissions in this part of the world is really high, maybe inappropriately high due to different reasons. And we can't just apply the protocols for the critically ill patients in the high-income settings, because our etiologies are different. You know that HIV, tuberculosis are quite common, and so many other tropical diseases, and antibiotic resistance, quality of the antibiotics, so there are so many problems, and certain interventions are proven to be even ineffective and harmful, which are there in the Western protocols. So it's a challenge to improve our knowledge, and also so defining the ICU population in terms of assessing the outcome benefits is a challenge, because not that everybody who warrants ICU are being treated in the intensive care in our region, because some of the patients, as you all know, will be treated in the wards with organ supports. So they are technically the intensive care patients. So end-of-life care application is not going to be the easiest thing related to the cultural differences and so on. So we don't basically have data, so we need to find data to see whether patients will be benefited. So if you look at the previous case, the one I was discussing, what are the prospects of survival during this hospital admission, how to prognosticate this patient, where should the patient be cared, and what if there's a cardiac arrest. So the answers to these questions are not simple, but you can see the physician who can foresee the cause of, foretell the cause of the illness, is the most highly esteemed by great Hippocrates, the father of the modern medicine. So we need to prognosticate the patients who are admitted to the critical care. So because we know the three great skills of medicine, the diagnosis, treatment, and the prognostication. So we need to find ways to improve the patients who are diagnosing patients who are dying. So dying diagnosis is not going to be easy in contrast to the diagnosing death. So diagnosing dying may involve different trajectories, so it may incorporate physical, social, psychological, and spiritual dimensions. So even if we are talking about diagnosing DIME, there are so many barriers, simply because we as health professionals consider death as a failure, so we don't like to accept that. And there are so many other reasons. So we think that if you diagnose DIME, we are going to hasten the death. And there are unrealistic expectations due to different reasons on recovery. And there are conflicts in opinion among health professionals, between the healthcare team and the families. So absence of a definitive diagnosis is probably, the diagnosis itself may be DIME. We may not have a definite diagnosis. So people don't know how to manage the symptoms sometimes. They are not very clever on the communication. So many reasons are there. So we delay the diagnosis of DIME. So in medical curriculum also, we were never taken to see a patient who's DIME. So the students, even the doctors used to say, I don't remember being taken to see DIME patients. And we were always told to see the good physical signs. So even if you know how to diagnose, you are not taught to care for them. So it's interesting to see that new curricula incorporating these aspects. So we are kind of moving from the treatment models. Previously, it was about the curative treatment that is being applied at all strength to bend, and finally failing all of it, we may be thinking about end of life care, which is probably a little bit late. So the understanding is that we have to go by hand in hand, the palliative care and the curative treatments from the beginning. So as the curative treatments are not going to find the answer, probably we are moving more towards palliative care. That is how we care for our patients. So if you look at the GMC definition for end of life care, so they define the last 12 months as the period for approaching end of life care, because they say that the healthcare provider may be prosecuted if you don't educate your patient that if the patient is likely to die within next 12 months. But it's not going to be simple, because some of the patients are deteriorating quite rapidly, some of the patients are slowly deteriorating. So we need to incorporate all four trajectories that I have mentioned earlier to diagnose DIME. So trajectories are different, as you can see. We need to incorporate all the different planes of physiology, social, psychological, and the spiritual. And prediction is also not going to be very accurate. There are so many uncertainties associated with cancer patients. So they say accuracy is quite good, but it's a matter of practice. Unless you try, you are not going to improve on this. So we need to change us. So we need to consider changing the models of care, and we need to think about the structures for care of DIME, as I said, shown earlier, moving from rectangles to triangles. So this is a short survey done, most of the consultants working in Sri Lanka, short survey. So they all disagree, most of them are disagree, diagnosing DIME is not appropriate, the statement not appropriate, right? So they all agree that we need to diagnose DIME. And also, death should preferably happen in ICU. Most of them disagree, and most of them are strongly disagreeing. So is it the reality here? No, we still see nobody, majority are not interested in diagnosing DIME. Even they try to admit all of them to the ICU during the last couple of minutes. So we need to deliver a holistic care towards this critically ill patient in order to benefit them, the health system, society, and country in large. So it's a multidisciplinary effort, so we all need to be in this game. And teamwork, the family has a great role to play. So we need to pay more attention towards the comfort measures when it comes to the end of life. So decision making, so there are legal and ethical frameworks that we need to address. And there are emotional factors associated. We need to be careful when you are implementing these care pathways, and the best interest treatments are always encouraged rather than throwing everything that you have. So importantly, organ donation prospects are also there during the decision making. So again, you go back to the logo of Ceylon College of Physicians. So, according to great Hippocrates, we need to comfort always. Thank you for listening.